So today the topic which we are going to discuss is portfolio selection. Now, till now we have discussed many parts of creating portfolio with two securities, more than two securities, three securities, and how to calculate risk and return of portfolio. Now, today, the next part of portfolio management is portfolio selection. For example, you have three securities, right? A, B, and C. A, B, and C. So, you have these three securities, and you can invest, you can create n number of portfolios with the help of these three securities. For example, you may have 10%, you can give 10% weightage to security A, you can give 20% weightage or maybe 50% weightage to security B and 40% weightage to security C, right? For example, you have 1 lakh rupees in your hand, right? You have these 1 lakh rupees with you. And out of this 1 lakh, you can invest 10% in security A. It means 10,000 in security A, 50,000 in security B, and 40,000 in security C. Right? So this is one portfolio which you have created. Now, this is portfolio one. Portfolio one. Now, with these three securities only, you can create n number of portfolios as per your convenience, right? So, how do we do that? We can just change the proportion of investment in these three securities. For example, portfolio two. For portfolio two, we can just change the proportion. Portfolio A, for example, 30%, portfolio B is 50%, and portfolio C is 20%, right? So it means 30,000 in security A, 50,000 same in security B, and 20,000 in security C. So this is your second set of portfolio. So we are not adding any new security, but what I am doing here is I'm just changing the proportion of investment. So the portfolio construction has completely changed, and this is how we can create n number of portfolios with the help of same number of securities. Now, point is, what is the right proportion through which an investor can earn maximum with minimum risk? So the purpose of creating a portfolio is purpose of creating a portfolio is maximizing returns and minimizing risk. So this is the basic purpose for which we create a portfolio. So with these three securities only, although you can add n number of securities in these three securities as well, but I'm just giving you an example that if even if you have selected only three security, just by changing the proportion of investment, you can create n number of portfolios. Now, once you will create n number of portfolios, what is your purpose? Your purpose as an investor is to select a portfolio whose return is maximum and risk is minimum. This is what we want. So we can say that the objective of every rational investor is to maximize his return and minimize the risk. So any rational investor, somebody who wants to earn something out of it, so any rational investor would always want to maximize return and minimize risk. So diversification is the method adopted for reducing the risk. So as we have already discussed many a times when we learn how to calculate risk, that the simplest way to reduce risk is diversification of portfolio. Right. So the more securities you add to your portfolio, the risk would be reduced because you have diversified your risk. You are not putting all your money in one security only, but you are creating a portfolio where n number of securities are there. And this is how you, even if one security will not give you a good return, other security will definitely pay you off. So the simplest way to reduce risk is diversification of portfolio. It essentially results in construction of portfolio. The proper goal of portfolio construction would be to generate a portfolio that provides the highest return and lowest risk. As we discussed that, the purpose is to find a portfolio, the best portfolio, right? So, purpose is to find a portfolio with highest return and lowest risk. So, such a portfolio is known as optimal portfolio. So, for example, out of, you know, these three securities only, you have created, for example, 10 portfolios. By these three securities only, by changing the proportion, as I have just shown. You know, maybe in portfolio number three, what we can do? I'll again change the allocation of fund. So, for example, here the allocated allocation is 20% A. It means 20,000 security A and 40% security B. It means 40,000 and 40, again, it will remain 40%. So, 40,000 in security C. So, this is your portfolio number 3. So, you know, by changing the proportion, we may create n number of portfolios. So, for example, just by changing the proportion, we have created 10 portfolios. Say, for example, although you can create more than 10 portfolios as well, but just to, you know, simplify this example, let us assume that we have created 10 portfolios. Now, after you will, you know, calculate, after you will construct 10 portfolios, what you will do, you will calculate risk and return of the portfolio. Right. So once you will calculate risk and return of all the portfolios, as we have already, you know, discussed how to calculate risk and return of a portfolio. So once you will, you know, calculate risk and return of all the 10 portfolios, and out of those 10 portfolios, the portfolio which gives you, I'll just write it here, out of 10 portfolios which we have created just by changing the proportion of investment, the portfolio which gives maximum return with minimum risk is called optimal portfolio. Right? So this is the definition of optimal portfolio. Once you create 10 portfolios, you will select a portfolio which is giving you maximum return with minimum risk, is called optimal portfolio. So the basic purpose behind doing all these calculations is to find a portfolio with maximum return and minimum risk. So the process of finding the optimal portfolio is called portfolio selection. So the process of identifying a portfolio with maximum return and minimum risk is called portfolio selection. Right. So this is the process of portfolio selection. Now we'll one by one, we'll understand that how it is to be done. So the conceptual framework and analytical tools for determining the optimal portfolio is disciplined and objective manner have been provided by Markowitz model. So here the one model which we are going to discuss in this process is Markowitz model. So Markowitz model do is to help you to find the best model, right? So the process of finding the best model is also called Markowitz model. So his method of portfolio selection has come to be known the Markowitz model. And in fact, Markowitz's work makes the beginning of what is known as today's modern portfolio theory. We also call it modern portfolio theory. Right. So we will see how we select a best portfolio. Okay. So now the first thing we need to do under this method, the first step is, so step one under Markowitz model is finding, establishing feasible set of portfolios. So the first thing we need to do is finding a feasible set of portfolios. So how do we do that? So with a limited number of securities, an investor can create a very large number of portfolios by combining these securities in different proportions. As we have discussed that with limited number of securities, we can create n number of portfolios. So these constitute the feasible set of portfolios in which the investor can possibly invest. So these, all these portfolios, the 10 portfolios which we have created here is 10 portfolios which we have created by changing the proportion are called feasible set of portfolios. Okay, so now next is this is also known as portfolio opportunity set. These feasible set of portfolios is also called portfolio opportunity set. Right. So now we have established different portfolios. Now what we will do next is we will find efficient set of portfolios. The second step is to identify efficient set of portfolios. Now how we will calculate that? Let's first, you know, hypothetically what I'm doing here, I'm not actually calculating, but hypothetically, you know, I'll just write the risk and return of the 10 portfolios which we have created here. Just by changing the proportion. I have just shown you 3 portfolios simultaneously. You can prepare 10 portfolios just by, you know, changing the proportion. So we assume that we have created 10 portfolios. Now, hypothetically, I'm writing risk and return of these 10 portfolios which I have created. Okay. So let us understand. So portfolio number. Second is expected return. And standard deviation, or we can write risk, expected risk, and we can also call it standard deviation. Right. Now, portfolio number one. So, portfolio number one, for example, hypothetically, the return of portfolio number one is 5.6%. It is in percent. Okay. All the returns are in percentage. And we can say that the risk associated with this return is, for example, 4.5. Right, portfolio number two. So hypothetically, the risk return is 7.8% and the risk associated is 5.8%. Then portfolio number three, I'll just write 5, 6, 7. 10. Okay, so in portfolio number 3, the expected return is 9.2 and risk is 7.6. Then fourth is 10.5, risk is 8.1. Portfolio number 5, 11.7 is the return, risk is 8.1. Then portfolio number 6, 12.4, 9.3, 7, 13.5, 9.5, portfolio number 8, 13.5 return, and the risk associated is 11.3. Then portfolio number 9, 15.7, and risk is 12.7. For portfolio number 10, return is 16.8 and risk is 12.9. So this is the risk return trade-off for 10 portfolios which we have created hypothetically with the help of 3 securities just by changing the proportion. So now if you see the risk and returns of the 10 portfolios, we have to select a portfolio which is best suitable for an investor. So one thing we always keep in mind that choosing which portfolio is not about which portfolio to be chosen as a rule of thumb, but it completely depends on the investor's risk-taking ability. So maybe if somebody is not ready to take very high risk, so that investor can go for portfolio number 1, 2, 3 with minimum risk, right? But if portfolio number 1, 2, 3 have minimum risk, but the return associated with these portfolios is also less. It's not that high. But if you see if somebody is ready to take high risk, so then they can go for portfolio number, 8, 9, 10 or something, because return is also high. So this is a general rule, general tendency. It depends completely on the investor that which portfolio they want to select on the basis of their risk-taking ability. So there is no rule of thumb that which portfolio to be selected out of these 10 portfolios. But one thing we'll just discuss here. So here if you can see that in portfolio number 4 and 5, just observe these two portfolios, portfolio number 4 and 5. The risk for portfolio number 4 and 5 is same, which is 8.1. But the return of portfolio number 5 is higher. So, when such a situation will come, so one should obviously choose a portfolio with, same risk class, but higher return. So if one has to choose between portfolio number 4 or 5, they can go for portfolio number 5 because risk is same, 8.1, and return is comparatively higher, right? And similarly, if you go for a higher set of portfolio where risk is comparatively higher, so if you observe portfolio number 7 and 8, you will notice that the return in both the portfolios is same, but the risk in portfolio number 7 is less. Right, 9.5, but in portfolio number 8, the risk is 11.3. So if one has to choose between portfolio number 7 and 8, so one can go for portfolio number 7, which is 13.5 return and 13.5% return with the 9.5% of risk. So, while you observe these risk and return, one thing is very clear, either one should choose a portfolio with less risk but higher return, or one should choose one should portfolio with high return but less risk. So these are the two situations which are very, very clear from these set of portfolios, right? So when either you can obviously choose other than these also, like you can also choose portfolio number 1 where risk is minimum, or you can also choose portfolio number 10 where risk return is highest, or you can go for any risk return class as per the suitability of your risk taking ability. But once if such kind of situation arise where like portfolio number 4 and 5 where risk is same but return is different, choose the one which is giving you higher return. Or if there is a situation like portfolio number 7 and 8 where return is same but risk is different, you can go for portfolio number 7 where risk is less but the return is higher. So this is a general thing. Okay, so moving forward, if we plot all these portfolios on graph, x-axis and y-axis, if I plot all these portfolios on the basis of expected return and expected risk on a graph, so this is how we obtain a graph, right? Okay. So this is the graph we have obtained. So on x-axis we have standard deviation, and on y-axis we have expected return, it means risk and return. So once we'll plot all the portfolios on the graph, we will get these different points. All these portfolios will lie in this circle. So this circle, this shaded region, is called feasible set of portfolios, or we can also call them all the opportunity set, as we discussed that this is the opportunity set or feasible set of portfolios. So if we compare portfolio number C and A, here if you see C and A, both C and A are giving same return, because if you see same return, but the risk of portfolio A is higher and risk of portfolio C is less. So if one has to choose between A and C, one should always go for C, because return is same for A and C, but risk of C portfolio is less. And similarly, if you see between A and B, here standard deviation is same for A and B, right? But return of B is higher and A is less. So if one has to choose between A and B, one should always go with portfolio B. And similarly, portfolio E and F also, they are also on the same line. So E and F's return is same, but F's risk is higher and E's risk is less. So if one has to choose between E and F, or one can go for portfolio E. So this is how, we can choose portfolios. So now if you see, we'll see the quadrants. So if you see here that if we want to choose a portfolio which is best, we can choose different portfolios. Like if you see B to E, this set of portfolios, these. So here you see that the risk is on the minimum side, right? And return is on the higher side. And if you see from B to F, here risk is high, because from here we measure the risk. Risk is high and return is also high. So if you see for B to F, here risk is high and return is also high from B to F. If you see from F to, this A side, in this quadrant, if you see here, risk is high and return is low. So this is not a good, side. This is not a good frontier to investment, for investing. So for E, F to, this side, this is not a good frontier. One should never invest in a portfolio which lies in this quadrant. And if you see this quadrant, from E to, you know, ECDA, this one. Here, if you will see, standard deviation is less, risk is less, but return is also less, right? So here, risk and return both are less. Here, in this quadrant, AF quadrant, here, risk is high and return is low. So this is absolutely no-no. This quadrant is absolutely no. And in ECDA quadrant, here, risk is less and return is also low. So obviously, if somebody just don't want to take any risk, then they can go for, you know, portfolios which fall in this quadrant. And this quadrant, B2F, in B2F, risk is higher and return is also higher. But if you see this BE, this quadrant, if you go for this quadrant, here, risk is less and return is higher. So this BE is obviously the best frontier. So one should always invest in securities, in portfolios which lie in this quadrant. So this quadrant is also called efficient frontier, right? So here BE is also known as efficient frontier, where all the portfolios are efficient portfolios, the best portfolios. I mean, whatever number of portfolios you create, maybe you have created more than 10 portfolios also, and the portfolios which fall in this quadrant are the best portfolios for your investment, right? So here one more point I want to discuss, that point number C, this portfolio C. Here if you see the risk is minimum. So with portfolio number C, the risk is minimum because it is on the extreme left. So this is also called global minimum variance portfolio, where risk is minimum. So what we have understood with this graph, we have found two three observations we have till now. I'll just write it. So our first observation is between A and B, one should always choose, one should always select portfolio B. Why? Because A and B have same risk, but B's return is higher, right? So this is our first observation. Now our second observation is between A and C, one should select portfolio C. Why? Because A and C have same return, but risk of C is less, right? And then we'll discuss which frontier is the best frontier. So frontier B to E is efficient frontier because here risk is minimum and return is highest. So this is the best frontier, efficient frontier we call it. So this term efficient frontier is very important because, you know, whatever we'll study after this, everything will depend on this efficient frontier. So this is one of the most important concept which we have to understand. So this is called efficient frontier. Rest, if we see frontier, which frontier? B to F. In frontier बी टू एफ रिस्क इज हाई बट रिटर्न इज ऑल्सो हाई. इन फ्रंटियर एफ टू ए, दिस फ्रंटियर आई एम टॉकिंग अबाउट एफ टू ए, एफ टू ए रिस्क इज हायर एंड रिटर्न इज लोएस्ट. Right, so this is the worst frontier. One should never invest in portfolios which lie in this frontier. So this is worst frontier. Then we have in frontier ECDA, ECDA. Risk is less, but return is also less. Return is also less. So, you know, investors who are very risk averse investors can invest in these portfolios. Who just don't want to take any risk. But obviously, if somebody is not taking risk at all, the return would also be low. Okay. Then the last point from this is portfolio number C. This portfolio, this C portfolio has minimum risk. So portfolio C has minimum risk. And we call it global minimum variance portfolio. Right. So portfolio C is global minimum variance portfolio with minimum variance. So this is how we get our efficient frontier from now. Once we will, you know, we'll find our efficient frontier, after this we will find optimal portfolio. So the first step to find the, you know, step one, as we discussed in portfolio selection, the first step we need is establishing feasible set of portfolios. So we have discussed first step, which is establishing feasible set of portfolios. We have created all the portfolios, and out of these portfolios we have identified our, you know, efficient frontier. So this is step one. Now second step of selecting the best portfolio is selection of optimal portfolio, right?
So here we have obtained efficient frontier. This efficient frontier I have derived from the graph which we have prepared, which we have derived from the portfolios, from these portfolios I got this graph, and from this graph I have derived efficient frontier, that is B to C, this one, from B to global minimum variance point. Okay, so this efficient frontier I have derived from the above graph of the portfolio. Now, next concept which comes into line is the selection of optimal portfolio. Now we need to select optimal portfolio. Now, question is, as I told you that any portfolio which will lie on this line, on efficient frontier B to C, any portfolio which lie on B to C is called efficient portfolio. It is considered to be a good portfolio, a profitable portfolio. Now point is, which portfolio I should pick? Maybe, you know, there can be n number of portfolios which will lie on this line, right? From B to, for example, C, D, E, F, n number of portfolios will be there, or from B to C. Now question is, which portfolio I can choose? So you know, here comes the question, what is my budget, right? Obviously, if for example, if I have 1 lakh rupees, maybe I can pick this portfolio. If I have 2 lakh rupees, I will go for higher portfolio. If I'm going to invest 5 lakh rupees, I will pick this portfolio where return is also increasing. Risk is increasing, but return is also increasing. So, you know, the more higher you go on this efficient frontier, the more investment you have to make, right? So the more higher you go on this efficient frontier, the more investment you have to make. But obviously, we also have limited funds. We do not have those much funds that I can invest on this highest point, maybe B. But maybe I have lesser funds. I do not have that much of funds with me that I can invest in a portfolio with this much of return, like B point, right? Maybe I have investment only up to this point, like in the middle, right? So I have to pick a portfolio which also suits my budget, which also suits the funds available to me, right? So, rational investor will obviously prefer to invest in efficient portfolios. So, any rational investors would definitely pick a portfolio from B to C. So, the particular portfolio that an investor will select from the efficient frontier will depend on investor's degree of aversion of risk. So, I told you that there are few factors on the basis of which, I'll just write it down. So there are few factors on the basis of which an investor will pick any portfolio which is on the efficient frontier. Which is on the efficient frontier B to C, right? So what are those factors on the basis of which the investor will pick any portfolio which is lying upon B to C? So let's discuss few points here. So the first point can be the funds available. How much funds the investor have? If the investor has more funds, he or she may choose a portfolio on the upper side of the frontier, right? On the other hand, if the funds are less, investor can pick a portfolio from the lower edge of the efficient frontier, right? So the first factor which can, you know, really help you to understand which portfolio to be choose is how much fund do you have in your hand. So you don't have to pick, you know, a portfolio which is very costly for you. Obviously, your funds availability matters a lot. So if you have more funds, pick a portfolio from upper side. If you have lesser funds, pick a portfolio from this end, right? Then moving forward, what is the next factor on the basis of which you can pick a portfolio? So the second factor is the risk taking ability. How much risk you are ready to take, right? If the investor is if the investor is risk taker, he or she can choose a portfolio which is on the upper side of efficient frontier. And if the investor is risk averse, he or she can choose a portfolio from lower edge of the efficient frontier. Right. So these are two factors on the basis of which you can pick a portfolio from this, efficient frontier. So the selection of the portfolio, optimal portfolio, does depend on investor's risk aversion, or conversely on the risk tolerance. How much risk tolerance the investor has, on that basis, he will pick a portfolio from this frontier. So the indifference curve of an investor. So you can see this indifference curve. Here we have the indifference curve, right? So this indifference curve, you have also studied in economics. So here, if you can see, we have three indifference curves with us, I1, I2 and I3, right? So these I1, I2 and I3, the higher the indifference curve, the more funds you require, right? So, but on each indifference curve from this to this, no matter which portfolio you will pick, each portfolio will give you equal level of satisfaction. So if you have higher fund, you can go move to I3. But if you have lesser funds, you can move to I2 or even I1. So this indifference curve we have to create as per the availability of funds we have, right? So this point, this I2, basically shows us the availability of funds we have with us. So the point where this efficient frontier and this indifference curve. So efficient frontier basically tells you that how many portfolios are available to you, right? And this I2 basically tells you how much funds you have. So efficient portfolio intersected by the funds you have. So the point where indifference curve and this efficient frontier intersect with each other is called the optimal portfolio. So this optimal portfolio may vary from person to person. So if somebody is having more funds, maybe the point of intersection would be something else, right? So you have to pick how much funds you have, and on the basis of your funds availability, you pick the efficient portfolio, the optimal portfolio. We don't call it efficient portfolio, but we call it optimal portfolio. Why do we call it optimal portfolio? Because, you know, optimal portfolio is a portfolio which is giving you maximum return, minimum risk, plus your funds availability. That's why we call it optimal, because it matches your financial needs also. That this is the fund I have, I can afford this much only. So that's why we call it optimal portfolio. Otherwise, rest of the portfolios are also obviously good portfolios. So for example, if any portfolio above Q point is giving you better returns, but obviously you do not have that much of funds with you, right? So that's why this is optimal portfolio for you. This is O dash, right? So the indifference curve of an investor, each curve represent different combination of risk and return, all of which are equally satisfactory to the concerned investor. So this shows you different risk and return, fund availability also, risk and return also, because the more money you invest, it means more risk you are taking, right? So the investor is indifferent between the successive points in the curve. It doesn't matter to investor which point he is going to pick, but he has to see that this is the fund I have and this is the risk return ability of my risk return ability, and this is the funds available, and wherever it will intersect, that is my, you know, optimum point of portfolio. So this portfolio I will select, right? So this is how we calculate, this is how we choose the best portfolio as per our needs, right? So here I can say that the investor's goal would be to maximize his utility by moving up to the higher utility curve. So it is important that gradually I would try to, you know, move up to higher curves by investing more money, because once I will earn, I can reinvest that fund, right? So the optimal portfolio of a foreign investor would be the one at the point of tangency between the efficient frontier and risk return utility or indifference curve. So efficient frontier and this indifference curve is the point where the investor is highly satisfied. He is convinced, right? So I'll just write it here. Indifference curve basically shows the fund availability and risk return trade-off of the investor, right? How much funds investor have and how much risk and return he is ready to take. For example, if I say if I bear 10% of risk, I want at least 15% of return. This is what I want. Similarly, if I say as an investor, if I take 12% of risk, the minimum return I want is 19%, right? So these are different combinations. So doesn't matter, for example, I'll take another case, 14% risk. And now if I am taking 14% risk, I want at least 22% of return. So these are different cases. Okay. So either you give me this combination or this combination or this combination, I'll be equally satisfied, because if risk is increasing, my return is also increasing. So this indifference curve basically shows these risk return trade-offs, right? But obviously, always remember, if my risk is increasing, my fund investment would also increase. Say for example here, 10% risk, 15% return, maybe fund is 1 lakh. If risk is increasing and return is also increasing by default, so maybe here my investment is 1.20 lakh. And in third point, for example, again risk is increasing to 14% and return is 22%, then again maybe my investment is 1.40 lakh, right? So this indifference curve basically shows you different risk return combination of an investor, and either give me this combination or this combination or this combination, I will be equally satisfied, right? So so we are starting with CAPM model. Also, it is called capital asset pricing model, right? So this is the model which we are going to study today, and this is one of the most important topic in finance, in investments. So let's start with the topic. Now, capital asset pricing model was developed in mid 1960, right? So it was developed in mid-1960 by three researchers. So three, you know, financial researchers developed this model. Who were those researchers? First is William Sharp. Second is John Linter. And third one is Jan Mossini, right? So these three researchers developed this model, and this model is often referred as Sharp, Linter, Mossin capital asset pricing model. So capital asset pricing model or CAPM is really an extension of portfolio theory. Like what the theory which we have just studied now, this Markowitz theory which we have studied. This is also called Markowitz theory which we have studied. Portfolio selection, I would just write it portfolio or selection or Markowitz theory. Right, so fundamental of capital asset pricing model is Markowitz theory, and this CAPM model is extension of this theory. We are just studying a step further of the model which we have just studied now. So the portfolio theory is a description of how rational investors should build an efficient portfolio. So the Markowitz model basically tells us how a rational investor selects the best portfolio, right? So this is what we have learned in the Markowitz model, that how to choose a best portfolio. So this, you know, capital asset pricing model basically tells you the relationship between expected return and risk, right? So anything in finance basically tells you the relationship between expected risk and return. So this is also about the relationship between expected. Always remember that we use term expected. There is nothing actual. Always everything is expected. So expected returns and expected risk. Right? So it tells you the relationship between expected returns and risk of individual securities and portfolios. Right, so it will tell you the relationship between expected risk and return of securities as well as portfolio. Now we will understand the basic principles of portfolio theory. What are the basic principles of CAPM model? So return and risk are two important characteristics of every investment, right? So whenever we invest in any security, there are two sides of a coin. First is risk and other is return. So investors base their investment decisions on expected return and risk of investment. Obviously, you choose one. Any investor would choose a security. Any investor would choose a security on the basis of expected risk and return, you know. Like in previous model we have just studied like there were different combinations of expected risk and returns, and anybody would choose on the basis of what is return and what is risk, right? So these are the fundamentals on the basis of which anyone would choose it. So risk is measured by variability in return. So what is risk? Risk is basically variation in returns. Risk is variation in returns, right? Investors attempt to reduce the variability of returns through diversification. Now, how this risk would be reduced? Risk can be reduced by diversification of portfolio, right? So when you have more securities in your portfolio, your risk would definitely be reduced, because you are not putting all your money in one security. You are diversifying your portfolio. So even if one security is not giving you good return, other will definitely give you. So this results in creation of a portfolio. And with a given set of securities, any number of portfolios can be carried. You know, as we have discussed in the previous class, that If we have only three securities, like this was the example which we have discussed, there were only three securities, but we have created we have created many portfolios just by changing the proportion of securities. So any number of portfolios can be created, right? So and from which what we do is we try to find efficient frontier. So we understood that this is the efficient frontier, B to E. This is the efficient frontier which we derived from the portfolio, right? So diversification helps to reduce risk, but even a well diversified portfolio does not become risk free. No matter how much diversification you have done, maybe you have 10 securities in your portfolio, that also doesn't mean that you will not face risk. Risk would be there. In any case, risk would be there, right? If we construct a portfolio including all securities in the stock market, that would be the most diversified portfolio. Even such a portfolio would be subject to considerable variability. You know, even if you have hundreds of securities in your portfolio, then also you will have to face a certain kind of risk. Right. So what do we call such kind of risk? That is systematic risk or market risk. The risk which is unavoidable. Even if you diversify like anything, then also you will have such kind of risk in your portfolio. Right. So the real risk of a security is the market risk, which cannot be eliminated through diversification. This is indicated by the sensitivity of a security to the movements of market and is measured by the beta coefficient of the security. So that's why we calculate beta. You know, if you remember, we have studied the concept of beta. That was systematic risk, right? So even if you have n number of securities in your portfolio, then also you will have systematic risk, and that is called beta. So a rational investor would expect the return on a security to be commensurate with its risk. The higher the risk of a security, the higher would be the return expected. So as per the fundamental rule of stock market, what do we say? Higher the risk you take, higher the probability of return. So even if you have n number of securities in your portfolio, then also there is risk, and it depends on the amount of risk you are taking, the extent of risk you are taking, which actually determines your return in future. So ultimately we can say that return is expected to be correlated with risk only. Higher the risk, higher the probability of return. It means risk and return are two factors which are interrelated to each other. There is correlation between risk and return. So capitalistic pricing model gives the nature of the relationship between expected return and systematic risk. So what is the purpose of conducting capitalistic pricing model? Why do we use this model? The whole purpose of using this model is to identify the relationship between expected return and systematic risk. Always remember, here in capital asset pricing model, we are not talking about unsystematic risk. Like in previous question, we were talking about standard deviation. But here in capital asset pricing model, we are talking about beta, systematic risk. So this is the fundamental difference between Markowitz model and CAPM model. So Markowitz model used to deal with unsystematic risk, that where we use standard deviation. But here in CAPM model, we are not using standard deviation, but we are using beta, that is systematic risk. There we used to identify relationship between return and unsystematic risk. But here in CAPM model, we are identifying a relationship between expected return and systematic risk, that is beta, right? So now let's discuss certain assumptions of CAPM model. So whenever we do any model, anything we do, there are certain assumptions associated with the concept. So here also CAPM model also deals with certain assumptions, which we'll discuss one by one. And you can also call it its limitations. CAPM model works under these limitations, these guidelines only. So here the first assumption is investors make their investment decision on the basis of risk return investment measured in terms of expected return and standard deviation of returns. So here the first thing is investors make their first assumption
investors make their investment decision investment decisions
on the basis of risk return
on the basis of risk and return only,
right? And and risk here the kind of risk they are talking about is standard deviation of returns.
This is again what unsystematic risk, standard deviation of returns, right? So this is the first assumption of CAPM model. Then second is the purchase or sale of security can be undertaken in infinitely divisible units. The purchase and sale of a security can be done in infinitely divisible units. So what does it mean? That even if you want to buy only one share, you can buy one share. You want to buy 100 shares, you can buy 100 shares. If you want to buy one share, 10 share, there would be lot size available in the market. So this is what it means, that you can buy securities as small as you want, right? So the third assumption is purchases and sales by a single investor cannot affect the prices. So the third assumption says that one securities, one person's buying or selling behavior, one investor's buying or selling behavior will not affect the performance of market. So even if one investor is selling too much, it doesn't mean the price of the security will go down. Or one investor or few investors are buying a lot, doesn't mean the prices of the security will go up. So it takes a lot of, huge set of investors to change the direction of the security, right? Fourth assumption. The fourth assumption says that there is no transaction cost. So this is quite an unrealistic assumption also, because there is transaction cost, but CAPM works under these things. So there is no transaction cost. This is our next assumption. Then there is no personal income tax. This is also not true, although in real world, no personal income tax. Then there is, the investors can lend or borrow any amount. So if you want to invest in market, maybe you don't have money today, then also you can invest by borrowing from market. Anytime funds are available to borrow, right? So funds are available to borrow. So this is our next assumption. So next assumption is the investor can sell short any amount of shares. The investor can sell short any amount of shares. So basically, if the investor wants to sell his shares, he can sell it at any point of time. It means market is highly liquid. At any point of time, you can sell your shares. The next is investors share homogeneity of expectation. It means they have in similar expectations. If one investor is ready to buy a share, for example, for 10% return with the bearing 7% of risk, every investor would behave in the same way. It means there is homogeneity in the expectation. Everybody belongs to same risk class, same return, right? So there is no change in expectation of the investors, right? So now next concept in CAPM model is, let us just continue with it.
So the next one is efficient frontier with riskless lending and borrowing. Efficient frontier with riskless lending and borrowing. So now here the term of riskless lending and borrowing has come into existence. So let us understand these things. So the portfolio theory deals with portfolios of risky assets. So till now we have understood that whenever you invest in a portfolio, in any security, there is, you know, certain set of risk involved. Right. According to the theory, an investor faces an efficient frontier containing the set of efficient portfolios of risky assets. So just look at this, graph again. Here we'll see that there are different portfolios on this B to E, but all these portfolios belong to certain risk class. There is risk associated, as you can see. This standard deviation here is highest. Then at this point, standard deviation is a little less. Then at this point, standard deviation is a lot less. So, you know, these points show that there are certain risk associated even with the efficient portfolios. There is always certain kind of risk associated. So now it is assumed that there exists a riskless asset available for investment. So, you know, if as a common investor, if we think about investment, we would not put our hard-earned money only in risky securities. We would always want to invest a certain portion of our income into risk-free securities as well. Right. So they say that it is not the case where people want to invest only in risky securities. They want to invest in risk-free securities. For example, if I have 1 lakh rupees with me, I'm not going to invest my 1 lakh rupees completely in stock market, but I would also like to invest my certain money in risk-free securities. Right. So the first thing we have understood here is that investors would not spend their whole savings into risky securities, but they would invest a certain portion of the total fund into risk-free securities. Right. So here comes the concept of risk-free investment. So investors would not put their whole income into risky securities, but they put a certain amount of their fund into risk-free securities also. So a riskless asset is one whose return is certain. Like of what security the return is certain? For example, government securities. So government securities are risk-free securities, right? Like bonds, like FDs. So these are risk-free securities. So government securities are risk-free securities. Right. Okay. So since the return is certain, the variability of return is certain. If you invest in government security or you invest in FDs, there is no risk. You are going to receive as much as you have been promised, right? So the investor can invest a portion of his funds in the riskless assets, which would be equivalent to lending at the risk-free assets rate, and namely RF. So basically, you invest in risk-free securities, then what he will do, he will make a combination of risk-free and risky assets. So out of, for example, out of 1 lakh rupees, if he has 1 lakh rupee in his hand, he may, the investor may, he may invest maybe 30,000 in risk-free securities, in risk-free securities, and 70,000 in risky securities. Okay, so he will make a combination of both the securities. So moving forward, this is how he is going to make his portfolio. So similarly, it may be assumed that an investor may borrow at the same risk-free rate for the purpose of investing in the portfolio. For example, now he is not. For example, risk-free return in a particular country is, say for example, it is 8%, right? So 8% is the risk-free return. So it is also assumed, for example, he want to invest 70,000 in the stock market, and he doesn't have 70,000 with him. So what he is going to do, he is going to borrow these 70%, but at what rate? He is going to borrow it at 8% only, because 8% is risk-free. So if he doesn't have 70,000 or whatsoever amount, right, with him, and he wants to borrow this amount from market, he can borrow at risk-free rate only. That is 8%, right? The funds are easily available at 8%. So, which says that there is no problem in finding funds from the market, in getting funds from the market. So he can use either his own funds also, or he can use borrowed funds also. So next, moving forward, the efficient frontier arising from feasible set of portfolio of risky asset is a concave in shape, as you can see here. It is concave in shape. This is concave in shape, the efficient frontier which we derived from the set of portfolios, right? This is concave in shape. When an investor is assumed to use riskless lending and borrowing in the investment activity, the shape of the efficient frontier transforms into a straight line. So when you have only risky securities in your portfolio, this curve is going to be concave. But on the other hand, if you have, risk-free securities also in your portfolio, this concave shape will change into a straight line. I'll just show you how this will change. I'll just show you. Just a second. Okay, so here you can see that earlier the curve, the efficient frontier, was in concave shape. But when you involve, so this, A to C, this efficient frontier, when it was in concave shape, it was including, this portfolio was including only risky securities. But this model, CAPM model, says that you are not going to have only risky securities in your portfolio, but you will also have risk-free securities. So risk-free security will lie somewhere here, right here, because here risk is portfolio, risk is zero. There is no risk in risk-free securities. So it is going to give you this much of return, but the risk is zero. So that's why the shape of this efficient frontier will change into a straight line like this, from this RF to here. And when you change the shape of, this efficient frontier, the optimal portfolio will also change. Earlier, the optimal portfolio was, I'll just show you. Earlier, the optimum portfolio was here, O dash. But when there are risk-free securities involved in your portfolios, then the O dash optimal portfolio will come somewhere here where your indifference curve will touch, right? So when you involve risk-free securities in your portfolio, the shape of your efficient frontier will change from concave to straight line, and the optimal portfolio will also change. So in this figure, let us just take few examples like to understand how to calculate different things here. So let us just continue with it. Now let us understand how to calculate risk and return in and as per CAPM model. Okay. Now let us start it. Yeah. So the formula which we use to calculate risk and return of the portfolio as per CAPM model. So the formula for return, RC, return as per CAPM model. So here we use omega R M. Okay. So here RM is market return, right? RM is market return plus 1 minus omega into risk free return. Okay, so this is risk free return. So this is the formula which we use for calculating risk. So here RC is return as per CAPM model. Omega is the weightage, or we can say proportion of funds invested in risky portfolio. I'll just write it. RC equals to return of the portfolio as per CAPM model, then omega is funds, proportion of funds, invested in risky portfolio. Then 1 minus omega is proportion of funds invested in risk-free security. Okay. In risk-free securities. Risk-free portfolio or security, whatsoever. Right, then there is RM. RM is market return. Market return of risky portfolio. And RF is risk-free return. Right, so this is how we calculate return as per CAPM model. Then there is formula to calculate standard deviation of the portfolio as per CAPM model. Okay, so standard deviation. So standard deviation of the portfolio as per CAPM model. the formula is omega standard deviation of the portfolio. Then plus one minus omega fund invested in risk free security, and this would be a standard deviation of risk-free security. So you know this second part of the equation would automatically will become zero, because risk-free security does not have any risk. So this second part, 1 minus omega standard deviation of risk-free security, will automatically become zero, and the formula would remain just this, only this side, right? So this is how we calculate risk and return. So now I think we can take an example. So now we will apply the values to this formula, and say for example the so this sigma m, what is sigma m? Standard deviation of the risky portfolio, okay, and sigma f is the standard deviation of riskless assets, which is obviously zero, right? These were the points. So we have to calculate two things. First is the return of portfolio as per CAPM model, or we can also call it, rather than CAPM model, we can call it combined portfolio. Okay, so let's call it combined portfolio rather than CAPM model, so it would make more sense. Combined portfolio. Combined portfolio is a portfolio where we have both risky and risk-free assets, right? So we have combined portfolio, and I'll just write the abbreviations for this formula also. So sigma c is, what is sigma c? Standard deviation of combined portfolio, right? Okay, so just write it, standard deviation of combined portfolio. Then rest of the things are same as we have discussed in the formula above. So here omega is again the proportion of funds invested in risky portfolio, and 1 minus omega is the proportion of funds invested in non-risky portfolio assets. Okay, now let's apply the formula. So few figures are already given to us. I mean, let us assume few figures. So say for example RM, here RM,
excuse me ma'am,
here RM is market return, right? Then we have, so for example, market return, we are given how much? 15%. So for example, 15% is the market return given to us. And RF is the risk-free securities. So this RF is, for example, return of risk-free securities is 7%. Right? Then omega. Here omega is proportion of funds invested in risky portfolio or risky assets, whatever you can say. So omega is given to us, so how much? 60%, that is given to us. So obviously 1 minus omega would be 40%, right? 1 minus omega is 40%. So you know this fund we always converted into decimal. So 0.40, and this is 40%, and here this is 0.60, right? So this is what given to us already. Now I will calculate on the basis of these informations that what is going to be the risk and return of the combined portfolio. So we have two formulas with us, RC, this. So this is RF, not only F. Maybe I forgot to write. So this is RF. Now I'll just copy it. So this is risk return of the combined portfolio. Formula for risk combined portfolio's return. And RC, and this is standard deviations formula. Here we have. So I'll just put values first in this formula here. So RC, I need to calculate. So omega is given to us, that is 60%. So I'll write 0.60. RM is given to us, that is 15, right? Then we have plus 1 minus omega, that is 40%. 1 minus 0.60, that is 40, 0.40. So this is 0.40 into risk-free return is 7%. So I'm writing 7% here. So when I solve this equation, the answer I'm obtaining is 11.8%. Okay. So the return of the combined portfolio where I'm investing, combined portfolio, there are few risky assets and there are few risk-free assets also. So the combined return would be 11.8%. Now the question is, if I want to, you know, if I want to gain 11.8% of return, how much risk I must take? I have to take basically. So, so now I will calculate risk of this portfolio. So omega is how much? 0.60. Standard deviation of market, it means what is the risk involved? Market risk. So market risk is given to us, that is 8%. I forgot to mention you earlier, but the market risk is, I'll just write it here. Market risk is sigma m, so the market risk given to us is 8%. So then the second half of the formula says plus 1 minus omega, it means 40%, 0.40, and then standard deviation of risk-free security. So here, you know, one thing we have to consider that there is no risk of risk-free security. So this is zero, right? So obviously the second half of the formula, this part of the formula would be zero. So it means the only valid formula is this first half. The second half would become zero. So 0.60 into 8 is 4.8. So the risk is 4.8, right? This is what we have obtained. So to gain a return of 11.8%, I have to take risk of 4.8%, right? So this is what we have obtained.
Doubt.
So here, you know, let us assume that if we change the proportion of funds, so changing proportion of funds may make a difference. Okay, so let us understand this concept. So for example, if I change the proportion of funds invested in the portfolio, combined portfolio, right? So earlier I was investing 60-40 risky and risk free. Now, for example, I'm making it risky 75%. I'm increasing my proportion in risky securities. So it is 0.75, and risk free, I'm making it rest 25%, 0.25, right? So I have changed the proportion. So obviously, if I'm investing more in risky securities, so what would I expect? I should expect higher returns, because higher the risk, higher the probability of return. So simply, we can say that if I'm increasing my proportion in risky securities, it means I'm taking more risk, then I should expect to get better returns, right? So what I will do here is I'll just calculate again risk and return. So I'll apply the same formula which I've applied earlier, and I'll just change the proportion, right? So let us first calculate return of the combined portfolio just by changing the proportion, right? So again, now here omega is 0.75, because in risky securities I have changed it, it has become 0.75. market return is here, for example, again we'll take the same market return, because we want to compare that whether by just changing the proportion of risk free and risky securities, is there any difference or not. So as per the financial rule, what should happen? If I'm increasing my risk, my return should also increase. So I'm just checking whether it is happening or not, right? So 0.75 market return is again 15% plus. Now here omega, 1 minus omega is 0.25, right? And risk-free return again 7. So I'm not changing risk-free and risky returns, that would remain same. The only thing which I have changed here is the proportion. So now the new returns are 13%. Because I have changed the proportion, I am investing more in risky security and less in risk-free. So my return has increased to 13%. From 11.8, it has reached 13%, right? So now what will I do? I will also calculate standard deviation of combined portfolio. So this is the formula. Now I will see how much risk is increasing. So to do that, what I will do, I'll just apply the formula here. Now omega is 0.75 and market risk is 8, right? Again, 1 minus omega is 0.25, and standard deviation of risk-free security is 0 again, because there is no risk involved. So 0.75 into 8 is 6%. So it means my risk has also increased from 4.8% to 6%. See, if you compare these two situations, you will notice that the risk has increased by, I'll just write it here. The risk has increased by how much? 6 minus 4.8. So this is how much? 1.2%. So your risk has increased by 1.2%, and the return has increased by 13%. 13 minus 11.8, so how much we are getting here is
again 1.2%, right? So you know, you can very easily see risk and return is increasing by same proportion here, right? But it may not happen in each and every case. So you have to be very, very careful how you are actually, you know, increasing the, changing the proportion of risky and risk-free securities. So it should not happen that risk is increasing by a larger extent and return is increasing by a smaller extent, right? So you have to be very, very careful about it, that by what proportion you are changing the risky and risk-free securities proportion. Okay, so so here it is very, very clear that how we can increase our return just by changing the proportion. We have not changed the kind of securities we are using, but we have just changed the proportion, how much we are investing in it, and we got a good return, right? So you know, there can be three situations. So first is omega equals to 1. If omega is equal to 1, it means the whole amount, the whole fund is invested into risky securities. It means 100%, right? If omega is less than 1, what does it mean? Only a fraction of the funds is invested in risky portfolio. Just write it. Only the fraction of the funds are invested in the risky portfolio. And if omega is greater than 1, so what does it mean? That investor is, so this point is very, very important. If omega is greater than 1, it means the investor is borrowing at the risk-free rate and investing the amount larger than his own funds. In the risky portfolio. Right. So, you know, this concept, this the third point is very, very important here. That if the value of omega is greater than 1, so it means that the investor is borrowing from market. It means he is not having, you know, his own funds. He's investing some of the part in the investment from his own pocket, and the rest of the investment is by borrowing from the market. And at what rate he will borrow from the market? At the risk-free, like this 7%, right? At 7%, he has borrowed funds from the market and he's investing that fund in the risky portfolio, right? So when we have created such a portfolio, where a portion of your portfolio, the portion of the fund invested in the portfolio is by borrowing from the market. Such portfolios are called levered portfolio. We call it levered portfolio, right? So when we have such a portfolio where a portion of the funds invested, where the portion of the funds invested is obtained by borrowing from the market, at risk-free rate is called levered portfolio.
So this term is very, very important here, levered portfolio. Okay. Now, you know, majorly what we assume is that whatever we invest in securities, in portfolio, we do not invest everything at our own, you know, risk. We try to borrow something out of the market so that, you know, our money should not be at stake. And this makes the portfolio even more risky, right? So such a portfolio where the money is invested by borrowing from the market, these portfolios are even more risky. So I'll just change the formula first. You know, instead of writing combined portfolio, I can write levered portfolio, right? Return of levered portfolio. So there is, I mean, just a small difference. So instead of C, I'll write L. Okay. So this is levered portfolio. RL. Okay. So this is return of levered portfolio. The rest of the formula would remain same, omega RM. And yes, one more minor change is there. Instead of plus, I will write minus because I have to pay back, right? That's why I'm writing it as minus, right? Omega into RM, market return, minus 1 minus omega into RF because I have to pay back, right? Whatever I'm, you know, borrowing from the market. Okay, so this is the situation given to you. This is the formula given to you. And the formula for levered, this formula we have, standard deviation. So I'm just copying this part of the formula because second half of the formula is obsolete for us because it becomes zero at the end of the day. So I'm just writing it as it is. Standard deviation of levered portfolio equals to omega into standard deviation of market. You know, this is the second half of the formula I have removed. I'm just writing the first half of the formula to save our time, right? Okay. So now we have a question. Let's take the help of an example to understand this concept. So what I'm doing here is the return and risk of an investor we have to calculate. Here, what I'm going to do, for example, he has borrowed a certain amount from the market. And for example, whatever funds he is having, he is borrowing 25% of those funds into from the market. Okay, just a second. So for example, the return and risk of the investor, we have to calculate assuming omega is 1.25 because total funds are obviously 1. If it is greater than 1, it means the rest of the funds are obtained by borrowing from the market. So here, for example, omega is 1.25. It means 1 he has invested at its own and 25 he has borrowed from the market. That's why omega here is 1.25, right? So now I will put these values into the formula. Control C. I'll just apply. Okay. So here omega, I'll just write it again. So here omega is 1.25. He has invested 1.25. Market return is 15. So 1 minus 1.25 is, we can write as, okay, so class, there is a small error which I have committed. I'm so sorry. So this is not 1 minus omega, but this is omega minus 1 because omega's value is greater than 1 this time because we are investing more than we have. Investor is investing more than what he actually has with him. So this is omega minus 1, not 1 minus omega. Omega minus 1. That's why there was some issue. Okay. So omega minus 1, how much it will become? 1.25 minus 1, it becomes 0.25. This is 0.25. Again, now RF here is again, would it would remain same like in previous example what we have used, this is 7. Yeah. So, 1.25 into 15 is 18.75 minus 0.25 into 7. 1.75. So how much I'm getting? 17%. Now if you see, the return has increased by borrowing funds from the market. It has increased to 17%. Okay. So now I have to see what is the risk I have to take for this. So you know, one thing you have to understand, the amount of risk you are taking in levered portfolio is more than what you were taking in, you know, non-levered portfolios. Why risk is more? Because in case you have suffered losses, then one, you will suffer loss, and two, you have to pay to the lender also. That interest part you also have to bear. That's why your risk is dual, both sides, by investment also, or by because you have to pay back to the lender also, right? So that's why your risk is increased. Now we'll see how much the risk is. So as the formula would remain same again, so here omega is 1.25 because you are investing more than what you have. 1.25, 1 represent your fund and 0.25 represent borrowed fund. So 1.25 you are investing, and the market risk is again 8%, which we took in last example. So it has become 10%. So you know, now let us compare that how much, you know, we have increased. So in previous example, if you see, the risk was how much? 11.8%. We'll take just this simple one, this example, 11.8, and this is 4.8% of risk. Now your return has increased. It has reached how much? 17%, and risk has also increased 10%. So let us see how much risk and return has increased. So return has increased by how much? 17% now I'm getting, and earlier it was 11.8. So it becomes 17 minus 11.8 is 5.2%. So my return has increased by 5.2%. And then we have risk. Risk has increased by, you know, we also always have to, you know, compare that if my return is increasing, then how much risk I'm more taking. So both the things you have to cross check. So now the risk is 10% and earlier the risk was 4.8%. So now my new risk is, I mean, the risk has increased by 5.2%. So again, if you see, the risk and return has increased by same proportion, but it may not be the case in every situation. So you have to be very, very careful, right? So because if you're borrowing funds, maybe it may happen in certain cases that your return is increasing maybe by 4% and your risk is increasing by 6%, 7%, then it's not worth it, right? If return is not increasing in same proportion, or maybe in a better proportion, higher proportion than risk. So you always have to check, right? So here we can write that the risk and return of a levered portfolio is larger than normal portfolios, where we are not borrowing something from the market, from normal portfolios. Okay, so one thing we always have to remember. Then moving forward, The levered portfolios would give increased returns with increased risk. Obviously, we have seen this in the example. And the return and risk of all the levered portfolios would lie in a straight line to the right of the risky portfolio. So this is, now let us, you know, try to understand this figure here. Okay. So what is happening here? This is the efficient frontier from borrowing and lending. So, you know, if you remember the previous efficient frontiers, here you see, actually the efficient frontier was like this. This was the shape of the efficient frontier, the first one we obtained, right? Then we saw that if I have risk-free securities in my portfolio, then there is a risk-free line. See here, right? Now, from left-hand side, you know, this there would be a straight line. Then the third, this frontier. Now the shape of the frontier has again changed. Now here you see. So this says that the return and risk of all levered portfolios would lie in the straight line to the right of the risky portfolio B. You know, all the portfolios which are on the right side of B, these are the portfolios where I have borrowed funds with me on the right hand side. Okay. So that's why return and risk is increasing. If there is no, you know, if there is no borrowed fund, then the shape would be like this only, like B to C. But because I have borrowed funds, this concave shape would change into a straight line. Because of borrowing from the market, the return is increasing. Earlier, the return was at this point, C point. But now, because I have borrowed from the market, my return has increased. Right? So thus the introduction of borrowing and lending gives us an efficient frontier, but that is a straight line throughout. So it becomes a straight line because RF is already straight because I have, you know, risk-free securities in my line that I have already done. From left hand side, I have already made this concave A to B into a straight line. One thing is this, but when I have introduced borrowings also in my portfolio, then from right hand side also, this efficient frontier will become a straight line, right? Like this. Now, as per the new portfolio, by adding two things in my portfolio, first risk-free securities and second by borrowing from the market, this concave shape of my efficient frontier, AC, will become a straight line like this. This way, right? So the line sets out all the alternative combinations of risky portfolio B with risk-free borrowings and lending. Now this from risk-free line, this is also called capital market line, right? We call it capital market line. So the line segment from RF, this RF to B includes all the combination of risky portfolio and risk-free. From RF to B, these are risk-free and risky. And from B to forward, we have risky and risk-free portfolio by borrowing and lending, right?
So there are few, you know, observations of CML, capital market line. So what are the few observations of CML, like on what basis CML works? So the first observation of CML is CML only deals with capital market line. Capital market line deals with only efficient portfolios. So this is the first observation of CML, that it only deals with efficient portfolios. But you know, when we invest in markets, there are not only efficient portfolios, there are inefficient portfolios also. So you know why inefficient portfolios are important? Because inefficient, first of all, let us understand what is efficient portfolio and what is inefficient. So efficient portfolio is basically the one which is correctly priced, right? So which is correctly priced. An inefficient portfolio is not correctly priced, it may either be overpriced or underpriced. So, you know, when we want to earn something out of market, it is not important that every time you invest in efficient portfolios which are correctly priced, but you also have to invest in inefficient portfolios which are overpriced or underpriced, right? So why overpriced portfolios are important? If the portfolio is overpriced, then one should sell it because it is overpriced. So it is giving you a better return, right? So it is giving you a better return. So it is good to hold a overpriced portfolio so that you can sell it, not at the time of buying, but at the time of selling. It is fine, right? Then there is, if the portfolio is underpriced, then one should buy it, right? So if any security is underpriced, one should buy it. It will also give you better returns, right? So that's why we always do not invest in correctly priced portfolios, but we also invest in overpriced or underpriced portfolio, which are also called inefficient portfolios, right? Then the other assumption, the other observation of CML is it only deals with return and standard deviation. It means unsystematic risk, right? So it deals with return and standard deviation, right? To which we call unsystematic portfolio, unsystematic risk. Okay. So it deals with return and standard deviation, that is called unsystematic risk. But you know what is the problem with this assumption? This assumption here, you know, unsystematic risk can be, as we have studied, that unsystematic risk can be reduced by diversification of portfolio. Right. So we know that, as we have already understood the concept of systematic and unsystematic risk, that unsystematic risk can be controlled or reduced or can also bring down to zero if we diversify our portfolio. So in such a case, comparing returns with standard deviation or unsystematic risk does not make sense, because if the risk can be reduced, right, if a risk can be reduced plus or it can be bring down to zero, then why to compare return with standard deviation? So in such a situation, it is important to compare return with beta, which is systematic risk, instead of, you know, unsystematic risk. So these are major two things which we have understood by CML capital market line, that it deals with first efficient portfolios only, and second it deals with unsystematic risk or standard deviation. So you know, these two things, the bottom line of these two of CML is this. But obviously these two situations are not good for investor, because it will not help you to earn something out of market. So to overcome these problems, a new line has been developed, where what they do, the name of the new market line is the security market line. The security market line. Okay. So now the security market line will basically help you to overcome the above mentioned problems. How it is going to help you? Because first, what are the features of security market line? That first, it deals with both efficient and inefficient portfolios. It deals with both efficient and inefficient portfolios. So they help you to understand that you do not always have to invest in efficient portfolios. You can also invest in inefficient portfolios which are overpriced or underpriced, you know, to take advantage of market disequilibrium, right? So it deals with both efficient and inefficient portfolios, plus it compares, it establishes the relationship between returns and beta, right? So here, if you can see in this picture, this is security market line. Here you see that this is again risk-free return is always there, because we know that we do not only invest in what risky securities, we invest in risk-free also, and plus we borrow from the market also. This concept we have understood in CML, that an investor will not always invest in market with his own money, he will also have borrowed funds. So it will make the portfolio more risky, but obviously the return would also be higher. So what it is changing is that instead of, you know, standard deviation, here if you see in CML, on x-axis there is standard deviation of the portfolio, but here in SML, instead of standard deviation there is beta, right? So it is comparing beta and expected returns, right? So here we have understood that it is dealing with expected return and beta, and of course RF is there, that's why this line is straight, and after M this is straight because we have borrowed funds also. Now, which is an optimal portfolio as per SML? So market where beta is 1, where beta 1 and market return intersect with each other, right? Where 1 beta, what is the meaning of 1 beta? Where you are facing same risk as per the market. You know, there is no more risk or less risk than market. So where beta is 1, and market return. So where RM and beta 1 intersect with each other, this M point is the optimal portfolio. But as I told you that in SML, we are not looking only for optimal portfolio. We are looking for portfolios which may be underpriced or which may be overpriced, because we want to earn. So how do we understand this concept? Now let's move forward to next figure. Here you see. So there are different types of portfolios, as you can see in the graph. So any portfolio which lie on this SML, this is SML, right? Security market line L, M and N. So these three portfolios are optimal portfolios, or we can call, or not optimal, but efficient portfolio, right? Optimal portfolio is only one, which is M. So L, M and N is efficient portfolio, which is correctly priced, okay? And the portfolio above LMN, it means A, B and C. These A, B and C, these three portfolios are above. So if you, you know, if you compare, let's really compare A, L and P. We have these three portfolios with us. So L is correctly priced. Now if you see A, so A is giving you better return. Here if you see, the return is above, right? But risk is same. So when a portfolio is giving you better return, so it is called underpriced portfolio. Okay, that with same risk it is giving you better return, so it is called underpriced portfolio. But P, if you see P, the risk is 0.7 as A and L, but the return is less, so it is called overpriced portfolio. Okay, similarly, if you compare B, M and Q, we have three portfolios in the straight line, B, M and Q, and which belong to same risk class, because the risk of B, M and Q is 1, right? And B may be assumed to be this portfolio, B, because it is having similar risk. Risk is same as M and Q, but the return is higher, right? So we can call it underpriced, and Q is overpriced, because with same risk class it is giving you lesser returns. And similar is the case of C, N and R. N is correctly priced, C is underpriced, and R is overpriced. So any portfolio which lie above SML is underpriced. So A, B and C is underpriced and P, Q and R are overpriced portfolios, right? So this is how we understand the concept of CAPM. So how CAPM, capital asset pricing model, basically helps you to identify which portfolio is overpriced, which portfolio is underpriced. So you know what we have to do? If I am holding a portfolio A, what should I do? If I am currently holding a portfolio A, immediately I should sell it, because what will happen, it is, you know, giving you better return. Maybe in future the price of the return will go down, it will come to its original point L, so we should sell it. So anything, you know, which is giving you better return at this point of time, you should sell it, right? If I want to establish a relationship between risk and return with the help of CAPM model, how will I do that? So the formula to calculate return as per CAPM model, I'll just write the formula. What formula we will apply here? Just a second. So this is the formula to calculate return as per CAPM model, right? So this tells us the relationship between risk and return as per CAPM model. So here RI is the return of the security, RF is the risk-free return, and beta is the risk of the security, RM is again market risk minus risk free return, right? So this is the formula to calculate return as per CAPM model. So now let us try to understand this with the help of an example. So for example, we have two securities, security J and security K. Okay, so security J is having a beta of 0.75 and K has a beta of 1.45. Okay, and calculate the expected return. Yes, so we have beta of J and K as given to us, and then the risk-free rate is, then we need risk-free rate, risk-free return. Just a second. So risk-free return here is 5%. So, you know, this risk-free return is obtained by, you know, by checking what is the bond rate going on in the market or treasury bill rate going in the market. So, accordingly, you can find what is the risk-free return in a particular market. So, this risk-free return can vary from market to market, okay? So, then risk-free return is there, and then the market return. So, this market return can be calculated by Nifty 50's return can be considered as market return, or NSE 500's return can be considered as market return. Okay, so this is 14% given to you here. Okay, now we need to calculate return for security J and security K. So here, risk-free return is given to us, that is 5%. I'll write 5 here. 5 plus beta is given to us, that is how much? 0.75 for security 1, right? RM is how much? 14%. So 14 minus risk-free is 5. So once we'll solve it, the answer is 11.75%. This is the return. Okay. So similarly, this is for security J. Now, similarly, we will calculate for security K also. Okay, so here RF is again 5%. The beta is 1.45. RM is 15 given to us. Sorry, RM is 14. So this is 14 minus 5. So here the return is 18.05. So, you know, as you can see that if the value of beta is greater, it means greater the risk, greater the return, as you can see in both the securities. So here we have the question. We'll just study the question once again. So the following data is available. You are a portfolio manager and you have to identify that, you know, which security is suitable for your investment, right? So we are given five security A, B, C, D, E. Their estimated returns and beta and standard deviation. It means returns, systematic risk and unsystematic risk is given to you. Market index, return, beta and standard deviation is given to you. And government securities risk-free return, that is 7% and its risk is zero, whether systematic or unsystematic is zero. And now what I have to do is I have to find which security is underpriced. Okay. So let's really do this question. Okay. So now we'll apply CAPM model here. Whenever we need to find whether the security is overpriced or underpriced, we will always use CAPM model. Okay. So this is the formula given to us. So now I will just use security A. Security B, security C, security D, and security E. So here I'll just apply the formula. Risk free return is 7 plus beta of security A is 2. Here you can see the beta of security A is 2. So I'll just apply 2 here. Then market return is 15. Here you see market return is 15 and risk-free return is 7. So 15 minus 7. 15 minus 7. This is given to us. And once I'll solve it, return is 23%. Now similarly, I will solve for all the securities, right? Okay, so security B's beta is 1.5, security C is 1.0, security D is 0.8, and security E is 0.5. Okay, so these are all the values given to us. Now I will just calculate what is the return in each case. So security B's return is 19%, right? This is 19%. C is 15%. Then this is 13.4%. 11%, right? So this is all given to us. Now we have calculated the returns as per CAPM model. So now I have to compare expected return, I mean these returns with these returns which are already given to us, okay? Expected return and estimated return, right? So let's compare. A, B, C, D, and E. So these are estimated returns, okay? Expected return, and this is estimated return, right? And this is 23, 19, 15, 13.4, then we have 11. So now we can compare expected and estimated returns. So a security whose estimated return is greater than expected is assumed to be underpriced, right? So we need to see whose estimated return is greater than expected. So estimated, this is 30 and this is 23. Right, so it is greater. Estimated is 30 and expected is 23. It means we have expected 23% return from security A, but actually it has given 30% return. Right, it means it was underpriced. Right, it has given more return. It has given more return to what we have expected out of it. We expected only 23, but it gave 30%. So it is underpriced. Right, similarly, now this is 25 and estimated is 25 and expected is 19. It means we expected only 19%, but the return which the security gave is 25. So this is also underpriced security, right? Here, now the third one, see, again we expected only 15% and it gave 20%, so again it is underpriced. Now this is, we expected 13.4, but it gave only 11.5. So this is overpriced, right? We expected more, but it gave actually very less. Again, we expected 11, but it gave 10. So it is also overpriced, right?